This is an auto-narrated audiobook, generated by Google. Book, The School for Husbands by Jean-Baptiste Poquelin, Moliere. Introductory Notice. The School for Husbands was the first play in the title of which the word school was employed, to imply that over and above the intention of amusing, the author designed to convey a special lesson to his hearers. Perhaps Moliere wished not only that the general public should be prepared to find instructions and warnings for married men, but also that they who were wont to regard the theater as injurious or at best trivial should know that he professed to educate as well as to entertain. We must count the adoption of similar titles by Sheridan and others amongst the tributes by imitation to Moliere's genius. This comedy was played for the first time at Paris on the 24th of June, 1661. And met with great success. On the 12th of July following, it was acted at Vaux, the country seat of Fouquet, before the whole court, Monsieur, the brother of the King and the Queen of England, and by them also was much approved. Some commentators say that Moliere was partly inspired by a comedy of Lope de Vega, La Discreta Enamorada, the Cunning Sweetheart, also by a remodeling of the same play by Moretto, No Puede Esser Guardar Una Mujer, One Cannot Guard a Woman, but this has lately been disproved. It appears, however, that he borrowed the primary idea of his comedy from the Adelphi of Terence, and from a tale, The Third of the Third Day, in the Decameron of Boccaccio, where a young woman uses her father confessor as a go-between for herself and her lover. In the Adelphi, there are two old men of dissimilar character who give a different education to the children they bring up. One of them is a dotard who, after having for 60 years been sullen, grumpy, and avaricious, becomes suddenly lively, polite, and prodigal. This Moliere had too much common sense to imitate. The School for Husbands marks a distinct departure in the dramatist's literary progress. As a critic has well observed, it substitutes for situations produced by the mechanism of plot, characters which give rise to situations in accordance with the ordinary operations of human nature. Moliere's method, the simple and only true one, and consequently the one which incontestably establishes the original talent of its employer, is this: at the beginning of a play, he introduces his principal personages, sets them talking, suffers them to betray their characters, as men and women do in everyday life, expecting from his hearers that same discernment which he has himself displayed in detecting their peculiarities, imports the germ of a plot in some slight misunderstanding or equivocal act, and leaves all the rest to be affected by the action and reaction of the characters which he began by bringing out in bold relief. His plots are thus the plots of nature, and it is impossible that they should not be both interesting and instructive. That his comedies, thus composed, are besides amusing, results from the shrewdness with which he has selected and combined his characters, and the art with which he arranges the situations produced. The character comedies of Moliere exhibit, more than any others, the force of his natural genius and the comparative weakness of his artistic talent. In the exhibition and the evolution of character, he is supreme. In the unraveling of his plots and the denouement of his situations, he is driven too willingly to the deus ex machina. The School for Husbands was directed against one of the special and prominent defects of society in the age and country in which Moliere lived. Domestic tyranny was not only rife, but it was manifested in one of its coarsest forms. Sganarelle, though 20 years younger than Ariste and not quite 40 years old, could not govern by moral force, he relied solely on bolts and bars. Physical restraint was the safeguard in which husbands and parents had the greatest confidence, not perceiving that the brain and the heart are always able to prevail against it. This truth Moliere took upon himself to preach, and herein he surpasses all his rivals, in nothing more than in the artistic device by which he introduces the contrast of the wise and trustful Ariste, Racinier as he is called in French, rewarded in the end by the triumph of his more humane mode of treatment. Moliere probably expresses his own feelings by the mouth of Ariste, for the School for Husbands was performed on the 24th of June, 1661, and about 8 months later, on the 20th of February, 1662, he married Armande Beigert, being then about double her age. As to Sganarelle in this play, he ceases to be a mere buffoon, as in some of Moliere's farces, and becomes the personification of an idea or of a folly which has to be ridiculed. Moliere dedicated the school for husbands to the Duke of Orleans, the king's only brother, in the following words. My lord, I here show France things that are but little consistent. Nothing can be so great and superb as the name I place in front of this book, and nothing more mean than what it contains. Every one will think this a strange mixture, and some, to express its inequality, may say that it is like setting a crown of pearls and diamonds on an earthen statue and making magnificent porticos and lofty triumphal arches to a mean cottage. But my lord, my excuse is that in this case I had no choice to make, and that the honor I have of belonging to your royal highness, footnote, Moliere was the chief of the troupe of actors belonging to the Duke of Orleans, who had only lately married and was not yet 21 years old, absolutely obliged me to dedicate to you the first work that I myself published. Footnote, Cigannarelle had been borrowed by New Villainen, The Pretentious Ladies was only printed by Moliere, because the copy of the play was stolen from him, Don Garcia of Navarre was not published till after his death in 1682. It is not a present I make you, it is a duty I discharge, and homages are never looked upon by the things they bring. I presumed, therefore, to dedicate a trifle to your royal highness because I could not help it, but if I omit enlarging upon the glorious truths I might tell of you, it is through a just fear that those great ideas would make my offering the more inconsiderable. I have imposed silence on myself, meaning to wait for an opportunity better suited for introducing such fine things. All I intended in this epistle was to justify my action to France, and to have the glory of telling you yourself, my lord, with all possible submission, that I am your royal highness very humble, very obedient, and very faithful servant. Moliere. In the fourth volume of the Select Comedies of M. de Moliere, London, 1732, the translation of The School for Husbands is dedicated to the Right Honorable the Lady Harriet Campbell, in the following words. Madam. A comedy which came abroad in its native language under the patronage of the Duke of Orleans, brother to the King of France, attempts now to speak English, and begs the honor of your ladyship's favor and acceptance. That distinguishing good sense, that nice discernment, that refined taste of reading and politeness for which your ladyship is so deservedly admired, must, I'm persuaded, make you esteem Moliere, whose way of expression is easy and elegant, his sentiments just and delicate, and his morals untainted, who constantly combats vice and folly with strong reason and well-turned ridicule, in short, whose plays are all instructive and tend to some useful purpose, an excellence sufficient to recommend them to your ladyship. As for this translation, which endeavors to preserve the spirit as well as meaning of the original, I shall only say that if it can be so happy as to please your ladyship, all the pains it cost me will be overpaid. I beg pardon for this presumption, and am, with the greatest respect that's possible, madam, your ladyship's most obedient and most humble servant. The translator. Sir Charles Sedley, well known through a history of a frolic which Pepys relates in his diary, footnote see Pepys Diary, October 23, 1668, wrote The Mulberry Garden, of which Langbaine, in his An Account of the Dramatic Poets, states, I dare not say that the character of Sir John Everyoung and Sir Samuel Forecast are copies of Cigannarelle and
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.